Good afternoon, everyone who's already joined for the webinar. So, and welcome all of you to this webinar. As you all know, Terry has been regularly organizing webinars on subjects related to energy, environment, and sustainable development. Today, the topic of the webinar will focus essentially on a very important but neglected topic, which is cycling in India. Cycling, as all of you know, is one of the most environment-friendly modes of transport. So we're going to talk about cycling today. Before we start with the presentation, I would like to introduce myself. I'm Akshima Ghate. I work as a research fellow at Terry, and I've been working on issues related to sustainable transport. I'm joined with my colleagues, Ms. Seema Singh and Ms. Megha Kumar, who've also been working on research projects related to sustainable transport. So we all welcome you for this webinar, and we would now want like to start with the presentation. In now sharing the presentation with you, I hope you are able to see the presentation. So we will now start. So as I said, we're going to focus today on a very important but neglected subject of cycling. And this whole presentation that we're going to present to you is based on a study that Terry carried out recently for the All India Cycle Manufacturers Association, and which was presented later to the Government of India. The focus essentially is that how can we promote cycling and bicycle industry in India? So to begin with, just to kind of get into the context, let's just answer the question that why are we talking about cycling today? It's essentially because of two reasons. One, cycling as a mode of transport hasn't received much attention in our country, in our cities, in our towns. And also because of that, it is witnessing a decline, which is definitely not good for our socioeconomic and environmental well-being. And above this, I mean, beyond these two reasons that cycling is witnessing a decline, there's some common perceptions about cycling that needs to be removed, which is essentially that cycling is a poor man's mode. And that is why a lot of us probably don't cycle. And that, and in fact, if you see on our roads, it's essentially the low-income population groups which are cycling. And that's true because we hardly see people like us who are cycling by choice to our work, to our schools, to our colleges. And what we have in India are primarily captive cyclists, essentially those people who don't have other mobility choices. Why people like us don't cycle is that we have a lot of mobility choices. We can use our two-wheeler, we can use our cars, we can take the bus, we can take the metro. But there is a significant class of population in our country which does not have these options of using a two-wheeler or a car or even a bus, and they have to depend either on walking to their places of work or school or depend on cycles to meet their mobility needs. So definitely this common perception that cycling is a poor man's mode holds true in our country, and also probably attaches a social status with cycling, which is definitely not good for its overall image to be used as a mode of transport. The other key common perception about cycling that we come across is that cycling is an unsafe mode of transport. And truly, if you look around the newspapers, you would find several news items talking about how cyclists are being killed in road accidents, road traffic accidents. And well, then it does not associate cycles as being unsafe. It's really an unsafe mode of transport for the cyclist per se. If I am a cyclist, the safety issue is related to me. So definitely I will think twice while deciding to cycle. And this is all happening because we haven't provided cyclists any right of way. While we have given right of way to cars, to two-wheelers, to buses, to other modes of motorized transport, we have not given any right of way to cyclists in our cities, and definitely because of which they are at the risk of being hit by motor vehicles. And interestingly, what we see around is that several cities, big cities like, for example, Calcutta, banning the use of cycles in several parts of the cities. So this is something, a scenario that we are heading towards. And a lot of us who are in the cars and two-wheelers think of cycles as being a nuisance for motorists. Well, it is not difficult to decide as to which mode is causing nuisance for which other modes of transport. I mean, whether it is these huge cars which are causing a nuisance, or it is this poor cyclist who is just occupying a fraction of space, a fraction of road space, if that person is causing nuisance. So a lot of these common perceptions about cycling, a lot of these issues which have, in which we have neglected cyclists, are essentially the reasons why we are talking about cycling today. And that's why Terry, in association with the All India Cycle Manufacturers Association, took up this study to understand what are the current patterns of growth of cycling in our country, how is the cycle industry growing, and we aim to look at promoting cycling both in urban and rural India, and also suggesting measures to make Indian bicycle industry globally competitive. Why we looked at the industry is that we, because we wanted to look both at the supply and demand side. So the key focus areas of the study that Terry undertook were three. We focused on understanding and suggesting how to promote cycle ownership among low-income households in our country. As you would see in the slide that are to come up, cycle ownership per se is also quite low in our country, especially amongst the low-income households. Also, then the other thing that we looked at was promoting cycling as a choice mode of transport. People like us who have mobility choices should choose cycles as a choice mode of transport. And the last thing that we focused upon in our study was to promote growth and competitiveness of Indian bicycle industry. To begin with, we'll talk about cycle ownership in India. So, as I said, cycle ownership in our country is very low. In fact, it's low and it is also growing very slowly. The growth in cycle ownership has been at a very slow rate of about 3% per annum in the last decade. And the share of households which own cycles has grown merely from 44% to about 45% in the last one whole decade. At the same time, if you see the chart, cars and two-wheelers have grown at a tremendous growth rate of about more than 10%. In case of two-wheelers, it's about 16% in rural areas and about 11% in urban areas. Cars have also grown, for example, in urban areas at a rate of 15% every year. And at the same time, cycles have grown at a very, very slow growth rate of 3% per annum. And over the last one decade, while cars and two-wheelers have doubled, cycles have hardly grown. I mean, they have just been grown at a rate of 1.3 times over the last 10 years, from 2001 to 2011. And if we compare the level of cycle ownership, which is how many households own cycles, so, for example, if we compare the cycle ownership per 100 rural households in India and China, we are, less than 50 households, per 100 rural households in India own cycles, as compared to almost every household in China, in rural China, owning a cycle. So that shows that the level of even the cycle ownership in rural areas, which one would expect to be high, because one would expect a lot of rural population to be using cycles, is also quite low. So why is this happening? So what are the reasons for slow cycle ownership in our country? It's essentially because the price of cycles in India is, if we compare it with the income of the low-income households, it is quite high. The price of the cheapest cycle in India, which would cost about, say, 3,500 rupees, that is about 15% of the annual per capita income in rural areas. And when we say annual per capita income in rural areas, that is actually about 20,000 rupees on an average in a year. So a cycle costing 3,500 rupees is quite expensive for a person for a household which is earning, say, 20,000, 25,000, 30,000 in a year. At the same time, if we compare the same numbers with China, price of the cheapest cycle in China is only 2.5% of the annual per capita income in the rural areas. And not surprisingly, therefore, if you see the difference in the rural cycle ownership, it is the Chinese rural cycle ownership is double that of India. In fact, to check this this whole relationship that we got in terms of relationship between price of cheapest cycle and the income, we went to several villages in India and surveyed people to understand how difficult it is for them to buy cycles. And what came out was, in accordance with the chart that you're seeing, people do find, in rural areas, people do find it difficult to buy a cycle. So this is essentially one key reason for very low cycle ownership in the country. And the other is that since the price of cycle is a deterrent, one would expect that there is some availability of finance to buy cycles. However, we surveyed people in the rural and urban areas, low-income population in these areas, and what we found is that loans for cycles are not easily available from microfinance institutions and commercial banks to these low-income population, whether be they in the urban or rural areas. For example, we asked people that how do they buy cycles. In six cities, Delhi, Lucknow, Meerut, Jhansi, Surat, Bangalore, about 200 people in every city who were using cycles. And the answer that we got is that they save over a period of time to be able to buy cycles. So they are not getting any finance from, say, a microfinance institution. For example, if you would know, microfinance institution provides finance for several things like sewing machines, like irrigation pumps, like, for example, even mobile phones. But for cycles, what we found is that microfinance institutions are usually not providing finance. And there are several reasons that because of which this is happening. But what we kind of understood clearly is that after going through these statistics is that there is a need to increase cycle ownership amongst low-income households in our country. Why? Because cycles are a direct income-generating asset for these people. For us, they may be a mode of transport which can be used just on and off, or something that will give us health benefits. But for low-income population, it is a mode of transport which can help them either, you know, access their place of employment in a faster and affordable manner, or it may be a direct income-generating asset for them. And, I mean, if you go around in the towns, villages, cities of India, these are some common pictures that you would see, that cycles are a direct income-generating asset for these people. They would load the things that they would want to buy, sell to the population and sell them on cycles. Imagine these people otherwise walking and selling this. They would not be easily able to make a livelihood. These are, I mean, some of the common pictures you would see around your, you know, in your cities and towns, that cycles are playing a very important role, but somehow their importance in helping these people earn their livelihood is missed by all of us, especially the policymakers. So what we recommended essentially is that, given that cycles are something that are enabling low-income population to earn livelihoods, so that's why we recommended that it's very important that cycles for low-income population, like many other things, should be subsidized, and why not? So we suggested that usually, and what we found is that usually these low-income population groups would buy cycles that cost less than 5,000 rupees. So we suggested that these are the cycle groups that we should target and subsidize, irrespective of who is buying that. And what we found is that how the government can subsidize is that we did some basic calculations and we understood that taxes account for about 12% of the price of a cycle. So just by waiving off these taxes, we can bring down the price of cycles to a range of about 2,500 to 4,500. And this would require annual subsidy of about 250 to 300 crores. And that we said is that is nothing as compared to, you know, how we are subsidizing many other items in our country. So if this can do, this 250 crore or 300 crore can do good for these low-income population groups, I mean, this is a very good beginning. And then a lot of people would have questioned us, so we already kind of, you know, looked into this issue, that would exemption of taxes on cycles really burden the government exchequer? Well, the answer would be no, because we are heavily subsidizing the users of motor vehicles, which are usually people who are middle income or higher income. I mean, just you'll be startled to know that, you know, the government of India gave a subsidy, petroleum subsidy of 92,000 crores in 2012-13. The largest chunk of which, which is about 60%, went to the transport sector. And that's not all. Even the excise duty on motor vehicles, as all of you would know, was reduced in the previous budget. Then above that, we are also giving incentives on purchase of electric vehicles. So if we can subsidize motor vehicles like cars and two-wheelers and buses and whatnot so heavily, then why not, you know, subsidize even the cycles, given that they are the most clean and the most sustainable form of transport? And beyond that, being clean and, you know, environment friendly, they're a very important enabler for the low-income population in terms of enhancing their socio-economic well-being. So support of about 250 to 300 crores is something that we at least did not find, you know, found to be high. And that's why we suggested that this should be the way to go, which is to subsidize at least the cycles that cost below 5,000 rupees. So the other thing that we focused upon was the availability of cycle finance. As I said earlier, finance for cycles is not easily available to the low-income population, and they do not have enough money to buy cycles. So what happens is that they have to save for a long period of time to be able to, you know, accumulate, say, 4,000 rupees in the household and then buy a cycle. So we said that, you know, there should be ways to provide cycle finance. And there is a scheme of the Government of India, which is called Priority Sector Lending, under which, you know, low-income population groups in rural and urban areas are given finance through the channel of microfinance institutions to, you know, to meet their needs of financing, say for buying a cow in a village or for some irrigation pump or some sewing machine or things like that. So we say that why should, you know, cycles not be included, you know, under this priority sector lending, and that is what Terry recommended, that we need to bring cycle finance under priority sector lending, and that was recommended, and that the microfinance institutions should be encouraged to provide finance for cycles to the low-income households. Another interesting thing that we found is that beyond just, you know, the low-income population groups, you know, the elders in the family, it's also the school children who would benefit quite a lot from subsidized cycles or free cycles. And we did some research and found that cycle ownership among school children has had a very positive social impact in terms of increasing enrollment and attendance levels, especially of girl children. In Bihar, for example, this free cycle distribution scheme that was started by the chief minister did help increase the enrollment of the girl students, similarly in Chhattisgarh. And as I said, you know, Terry did a lot of surveys in several villages, went to villages in UP and Bihar. And I mean, what we found is that students do come on cycles because the distances, I mean, to schools are very, very long, say 5 kilometers, 8 kilometers, 10 kilometers. Walking is really not an option. So students are actually coming to, especially to higher secondary schools, they're coming by cycles. And it would benefit a lot if these students are provided cycles either free or at a very, very subsidized cost. So it is definitely important. And that's why, especially for girl children, as you would see in picture, these are some of the pictures that we took while we were doing surveys in the rural areas and towns. And I mean, students actually using cycles to go to their schools, especially the girl students. So that's why we recommended that, I mean, given that these schemes have been successful, we strongly recommended that special schemes for promoting ownership of cycles by school children should be introduced by the state governments and even, say, by the central government. So this was with regard to the cycle ownership aspect. The other issue that we studied and, you know, suggested recommendations related to was on how to promote cycles as a choice mode of transport. So there are these two terms that, you know, I'm repeating again and again. One is linked to, cycling being a captive mode of transport. The other being linked to cycling being a choice mode of transport. So when I say captive mode of transport, I'm essentially saying that if I'm a captive user, I really don't have any other choice.
So, I mean, I can't afford to use anything else except, say, a cycle. But when I say choice mode of transport, it essentially means that I have several choices because I can afford several choices because my income, household income, allows me to use different modes of transport or afford different modes of transport. So I may have a choice of using a car, a two-wheeler, a bus, a metro, or a cycle, or even walk. So I'm a choice user. So today what is happening is that the choice users essentially choose not to use cycles because of several reasons, as we would see, you know, what these reasons are. So, I mean, the whole idea that Terry focused on was that how can we promote choice mode, you know, cycles as a choice mode of transport in our cities? So to begin with, we looked at the share of cycles as a mode of transport in our cities, and we found that it was quite low. Though, you know, overall, if you combine walking and cycling, the share is very pretty high, say about 50%. But cycling, the cycles per se are, you know, about in the range of, say, 5 to 15% in our total modal share, which is how different, you know, population categories are traveling in our cities. And what we also interestingly observed is that in several of our largest cities, say Mumbai, Calcutta, Bangalore, Delhi, Hyderabad, Chennai, Pune, cycle ownership, you know, the number of cycles, percentage, you know, households owning cycles has been declining. For example, we see a very sharp decline in the number of share of households that own cycles in Pune. In 2001, 48% households in Pune owned cycles as compared to 33% households owning cycles in 2011. So that is, I mean, beyond cycles being used as a mode of transport, which is the modal share thing that I talked about earlier, it is also the ownership of cycles that is declining in our cities. And this is accompanied by another phenomena, which is increase in cyclist accidents. The number of cyclists dying on in road accidents has been increasing. So there has been an increase of more than 1,000 cyclist deaths over a period of just 3-4 years, from 2009 to 2012, more than, there were, say, about 5,000 deaths in 2009, and about 6,600 deaths in 2012 of cyclists just on account of road accidents, which kind of gives it a, you know, image of being an unsafe mode of transport for at least the person who's, you know, riding the cycle. So, and that's why a lot of us would not want to cycle or even discourage our other family members not to cycle. And that's essentially the reason for decline in the use of cycles in urban areas. That is the, you know, lack of safe cycling conditions. The rising number of accidents kind of indicate that the cycling conditions in our cities are not safe. Then also, I mean, because of lack of innovative cycle promoting schemes like, say, bicycle sharing in our cities, something that you do see in several cities around the world, that, you know, even if you don't own a cycle, you can benefit from schemes like, you know, bicycle rental, bicycle sharing, and, you know, use cycles to meet your daily mobility needs. And also third very important reason we felt that we should not ignore is this whole social perception about cycling. And, you know, that cycling is, you know, I mean, this whole thing about, you know, car being more of a social status symbol and cycles, I mean, if you're cycling, you are a poor person. So that social perception is also something that is a barrier in terms of, you know, deterring us from using cycles. So it was very critical for us not to, you know, neglect this issue and give some kind of a solution for it. So the key issues, then we did quite some research on, you know, what's happening with regard to cycling as a mode of transport in urban areas. And few of the things that we felt were very important and have been neglected were related to infrastructure for cycling and cycle sharing schemes. So what we found is that very few cities in our country have constructed or plan to construct cycle tracks. In fact, what we found is that today we have about more than 50 cities having a population of more than 1 million. Out of these, only 2 cities had, you know, Pune and Chandigarh had some kind of city level network of cycle tracks. However, I mean, they had problems related to bad design, lack of continuity of cycle tracks, maintenance was a problem of, then lighting, there wasn't adequate lighting on the cycle tracks, even the encroachment, say by parking of cars and two-wheelers, and even enforcement that, you know, if there are cycle tracks, then even the two-wheelers are using, sometimes even cars are using these cycle tracks. So there were several issues, but these are the only two cities where we found that, okay, some kind of city-level network of cycle tracks existed. And also, I mean, the question then we asked is that why is that cities are not constructing cycle tracks? So we looked into the road design standards that are being followed by for construction of urban roads. And what we found is that it is a requirement in the standards that we should provide for cycle tracks on all arterial and subarterial roads, which is all the main roads in our cities. However, these standards, though they are there in the rule book, are not translated into actual road designs. There are no dedicated investments, therefore, which propose, you know, that are proposed for cycle tracks in the city budgets and the city mobility plans. And what we also find is that all of this, I mean, the icing on the cake is that there is no political will for promoting cycling. I mean, you will have the local leaders and MLAs and mayors talking about flyovers for cars, but you would not have a local leader talking about a cycle path for the cyclists. So that is the kind of, even the social, political environment that exists that, is not at all favoring construction of infrastructure for cyclists. Despite it being an important, design, it being there in the road design standards. And with regard to cycle sharing schemes, what we found is that not many cities in our country have experimented with, cycle sharing pilots. Only Delhi and Bangalore have done something. A few more cities have done something. Mumbai also did something. But Delhi and Bangalore were the only ones where we found some kind of good amount, pilot being done. However, over years, these have not been successful because these have not been citywide networks and have been limited to just a few projects. So what we recommended essentially is that to begin with, I think we just need very simple approach. That is, we just need to ensure translation of existing codes and design standards to actual road design. So as I said earlier, if as a local, a municipality or a PWD or a CPWD, I am responsible for constructing roads in say Delhi, Mumbai, Bangalore, or any other city, I just need to ensure that I follow the rule book, and the rule book clearly provides for provision of cycle tracks. So first of all, we need to ensure that those codes and design standards are actually translated into the onto the real, onto the ground. And then we need to ensure that the network that we create for cycle tracks is complete. It is a citywide network. And when the appraisal of road design and road city mobility plans is being done, cycle tracks are considered in that appraisal, without which funding of local projects of roads, say flyovers, etc., should not be approved. And we need to, if we are constructing cycle tracks, we also need to ensure maintenance of these tracks and have very strict enforcement mechanism to check, parking encroachments are not there, waste is not being dumped onto the cycle tracks. And we should also prohibit motor vehicles like two-wheelers from using cycle tracks. Another recommendation that we suggested was that there is a need for a push from the Ministry of Urban Development. As many of you would know that a lot of reforms recently that have happened in the urban transport sector in our cities have happened essentially because of the push that has been provided by the central government, essentially the Ministry of Urban Development. They have supported all big cities in the country under the Jawaharlal Nehru Urban Renewal Mission, JNNURM, to take up projects related to sustainable transport and essentially public transport. So several cities, as you would have noticed, have started running bus services. They have taken up projects related to metro rail. And all of these have been supported by central grants. However, if we see the pattern of central funding over the last few years, since say 2009, what we see is that the funding has been focused more on roads, flyovers, and public transport projects, but not on projects, focusing on promoting, say, cycling and walking, the non-motorized transport projects. So what we have suggested is that it's very essential that like Ministry of Urban Development has given a boost to public transport projects, it is also critical that the ministry gives a push to non-motorized transport projects and makes it a mandatory requirement for funding in the city mobility plans for public transport projects. So, for example, if as a city, I submit a project to the central ministry for getting funds for, say, a bus system or for a metro rail system, it becomes mandatory for me to, say, provide cycle tracks to get central assistance, to get central funding. So that is what we kind of recommended. Because if you see the numbers, what you would see is that the amount of money you would need to just build a cycle track would be very, very less. I mean, so you can definitely accommodate it in your budget for large infrastructure projects like metro rails, BRTs, etc. And then additionally, beyond the new project, cities should also be required to, you know, retrofit their existing road networks and ensure availability and provision of cycle tracks. And the third recommendation that we made was to implement and promote cycle sharing schemes. And in this also, we suggested that the Ministry of Urban Development should encourage and incentivize state and city governments to introduce cycle sharing systems. For example, the states and cities which implement good cycle sharing systems do get some better, you know, incentives with central funding. And state government should also support such provision of infrastructure. Then, if you remember, I just talked about this whole social perception about cycling being a poor man's mode in our country. So that definitely needs to be removed. And I mean, we cannot proceed ahead if that kind of a social perception continues to exist. So what we suggested that it's very important that there are mass awareness campaigns that are taken up and which highlight the benefit of cycling and make it a kind of a fashion statement for us to cycle. I mean, if you have, you know, the politicians, the ministers, the celebrities actually promoting the cause or even cycling to their offices and work, then I'm sure a lot of us would be encouraged to cycle. And why I say it so, because if we see, for example, in an advertisement, a John Abraham, you know, promoting a particular two-wheeler or a motorcycle, or a Shah Rukh Khan or some Sachin Tendulkar promoting a BMW or a Hyundai, we all kind of get fascinated, right? And we want to buy that particular car. So if we have the same celebrities, if our favorite politicians promoting cycling and promoting some good brands of cycles, then we would definitely see that change happening in the society. If they can cycle, I would want to cycle as well. So it's very important that this social perspective is also looked at. I mean, how we perceive cycling is therefore very critical. And if we see somebody cycling, we should not be saying, oh, that person may not be having the money to use a car, that's why that person is cycling. In fact, we should have the reaction, wow, that person is cycling. So, I mean, this person is really thinking about environment or, you know, is thinking about his or her health. So it's something that I would also want to do to myself. So it's very important that such mass awareness campaigns are supported by the government and even taken in a positive way by the public. And in fact, just to give you one more example is that, you know, for example, Ministry of Health runs these campaigns on eat egg every day. Eggs will make you healthy. I mean, the whole thing is that, you know, you're kind of putting into the public's mind is that it's important that, you know, you eat healthy stuff. Or if you have, you know, drives related to sanitation, that, you know, build toilets or tobacco is not good for health. I mean, similarly, you can have, and cycles are extremely important for your health, for the environment. So if we can have mass awareness campaigns like tobacco or eggs or sanitation drives, I mean, similar campaigns, if are designed for cycles, according to us, they would have a huge impact in terms of, you know, encouraging people to cycle. So that was all about cycle ownership and choice cycling. We'll now move on to the third aspect of our study, which is linked to the Indian cycle industry. So as I said earlier, in our study, we wanted to focus both on the supply and the demand side. And so it was very, for us, it was important that we also look at the supply side scenario and see why is that, you know, a lot of us do not buy Indian cycles, and why we would usually want to buy a foreign brand, and what is that is hampering the growth of Indian cycle industry, which I must tell you is not growing adequately as one would expect it to. So to begin with, to just talk about the manufacturing side of it, to just inform you, India is the second largest producer of cycles in the whole world, the first one being China. But the difference is huge. While we produce, say, about 15 million bicycles in a year, China produces about 80 million cycles. So, I mean, there is no comparison. Though we are the second largest, there is a huge difference as compared to what China is producing. And there has been a very moderate average annual growth of 4% in bicycle production in the last 5 years. As compared to China, this is quite low, where the product is more than 10%. And interestingly, what you would see is that whatever we are producing, our products are dominated by low value bicycles, which is the standard black cycles, what we call them. I mean, that's what is, you know, forming the bulk of our production, and they constitute about nearly 60% of the total production, and a significant other part being the cycles for children. And then coming on to the bicycle sales, we have about, we sell about 12 million cycles every year for the last few years. And there has been very moderate growth again in bicycle sales, about 6% per annum. Compare that to sales in cars and two-wheelers, which is more than 9% and 10%. And the biggest market for cycles in our country is in the smaller towns and rural areas, as against, in the larger cities. And then we talk about exports and imports. So, despite us being the second largest producer of cycles, we are also importing a significant, quantity of cycles into the country. And exports, as compared to that, are very low. I mean, while the exports of cycles manufactured in India has grown at a rate of, say, 10% per annum in the last 5 years, we have imported cycle at a much faster rate of about 25% per annum. These cycles have come primarily from China. I mean, if you see the left-hand side graph, all these cycles that we're talking about that we are importing are coming from China. I mean, almost 99% of them are coming from China. And whatever amount that we are exporting, it primarily to very low-end markets of Africa and South Asia. And we have a very insignificant presence in the global high and medium value bicycle exports. Like, we are not exporting to Europe and USA. We are exporting essentially our cycles that are manufactured in India to markets like Africa and South Asia. And that's why you can even relate it to the kind of products we are manufacturing, which is essentially the low value segment products, the standard black cycles that you see around people, riding in your cities and towns. So what are the key issues? As we said, the production in our country is growing very moderately. So are the sales. Imports are increasing and exports are to very low end markets. So why is this happening? So what are the key issues? So one of the key issue, what we kind of, as I said earlier, our study was supported by the All India Cycle Manufacturers Association. So we had access to a lot of information, and also we were in a position to discuss these issues with the industry leaders, and there are essentially 4 or 5 key industry leaders, say Hero Cycles, Avon, Atlas, and TI Cycles. The key issue that emerged from them is that, Indian bicycle industry is essentially facing technology-related challenges in both low and high-end product segments. And that's essentially linked to, issues related to lack of availability of raw materials to them, lack of availability of special components from the domestic component industry, and also the conventional and manual production technology, both for the components and sometimes even for the whole cycle assembly, and also lack of R&D infrastructure in the country for advanced bicycle technologies. And if we compare this with what is happening in the automobile sector, essentially two-wheelers, cars, and even to some extent heavy duty vehicles. I mean, all of these things, I mean, India has become a global leader now in automobile manufacturing. We have excellent R&D infrastructure, which is globally competitive. We're using best of technologies to produce our cars and two-wheelers. But this, however, you know, one does not can draw a parallel with the bicycle industry, which is essentially struggling with several of these technology gaps. And very interestingly, what we found is that there is no state-of-the-art testing facility for cycles in our country, which is essentially very important for us when we talk about the quality of cycles that we produce. So, you know, one would usually expect that if, you know, a cycle is being manufactured in the country, I mean, there will be some quality tests like you have in the case of motor vehicles. But we really don't have any state-of-the-art testing facility where the cycles can be, you know, certified for, you know, kind of abiding by certain safety standards, quality standards. And in fact, the tests, we have just one institution. There is this center in Ludhiana, Bicycle Research Center, which does some kind of testing. But the tests conducted by the Ludhiana center are not, you know, accepted in the global market. So which shows that, you know, we are far below what is required by global safety standards as far as cycle manufacturing is concerned. And there is a related issue of unsafe and low quality products penetrating in our market. There's several informal small scale players who have emerged who do not follow the quality standards prescribed by the Bureau of Indian Standards. And the products that they manufacture are usually, you know, not tested. And similar is the case with a lot of imported products that are coming from China, who are also not kind of, you know, tested for quality. So the quality issue is another key, you know, issue, big issue that exists with regard to the products, the cycles that are manufactured in our country. And the last issue is related to, you know, the global competitiveness of our industry. And so we suffer in terms of, you know, a lot of components not being manufactured, especially for the high-end cycles in our country. So we have to depend on these countries like China for imports, and the import duties are very high. There is high domestic freight cost if I have to export the cycles manufactured in India. And then there is definitely growing competition from China, which is way ahead from us. Even they, I mean, they're capturing the markets that we once kind of dominated, like Africa and South Asia. So, I mean, with regard to export competitiveness as well, Indian cycle industry is struggling. So the recommendations that we made were focused on, you know, bridging the technology gap with regard to, you know, what the cycle industry faces. We suggested a cycle industry upgradation fund scheme, which is that, you know, what was even given to, for example, say the textile industry in our country some decades back, and which has led to a complete makeover of the whole textile industry. So we suggested a similar technology upgradation scheme where the government will support technological advancements of the cycle industry and, you know, with an aim to make it more globally competitive. Then we suggested that a state-of-the-art bicycle R&D and testing facility be established in the country, and which, you know, kind of becomes a one-stop shop solution for our manufacturers with regard to testing and R&D. And then we also suggested that the existing center in Ludhiana, the Bicycle Research Center, should be upgraded and should be able to meet the international standards and requirements for testing. And the center should also, you know, focus on R&D and support the industry in terms of R&D of advanced technologies. And then once we have established a strong center in Ludhiana, similar other centers should also be established in other locations in the country. Say, for example, to begin with in UP, Bihar, or Tamil Nadu, where a lot of these bicycle manufacturers are present. Then we also need a monitoring mechanism to ensure adherence of safety standards by the manufacturers. As I said earlier, though some manufacturers are following, the quality standards prescribed by the Bureau of Indian Standards, several of them are not. So we need a very strict monitoring mechanism to see that the bicycles that are sold in our market are tested for safety and are, certified by a proper testing agency. And we need to set up an institutional machinery to, implement this. And we need to support the industry. The government needs to look into supporting the industry in terms of increasing their export competitiveness. And this can be done by reducing import duty on special components, by giving freight subsidy for domestic freight, and for negotiating import duty on Indian cycles that are, being sold globally, especially in Europe, where, we are struggling in terms of competing with China. So these were some of the recommendations that Terry made to, promote growth of the Indian cycle industry. All this that I just talked about and presented to you was also presented to several ministries in the government, with the relevant ministries like the Ministry of Urban Development, Ministry of Industry, Ministry of Rural Development, Ministry of Education. So we have, kind of shared our findings and recommendations with all these key ministries, which we thought could take an action on this. And there has been a very positive response, and some of these suggestions have been kind of considered and by these ministries. And we had the privilege of, the whole study being inaugurated and launched by the Honorable Minister of Health a few months back, Dr. Harshvardhan, who launched and supported this whole cause of cycling and cycle industry. And we have, as I said, completed the study. It has been shared in different forums now and with the key government agencies. The report is uploaded on Terry's website. I mean, the whole thing that I talked about is presented and discussed in much more detail in our report. And if you are interested, to read more about it, to know more about it, you can download the whole study report freely from our website. And if you have any queries, you can always write back to us, seeking more information or clarification on the research that has gone into developing and producing this report. So with that, I would like to thank all of you to be, patiently hearing to what Terry has done with regard to, this study, which essentially focused on promoting cycling and cycle industry in India. I would now be taking up, I understand some of you have been posting some questions as well. So I'll just take a break of a few seconds to just respond to three selected questions. I know it is not right for us to just respond to a few questions. So I've got three questions now. One is from Ms. Poonam Minde, and you have asked us about what is the future of NMT, non-motorized transport in India. Thank you, Poonam, for asking this question. So what at this moment we see is that with the current policies, if you just look at the policy at the national level, we may be able to say that the future looks bright, because the National Urban Transport Policy, which is guiding the growth of urban transport in our country, is essentially promoting development of non-motorized transport in the country. However, if you look at how the policy has been implemented since 2009, since the central funding was given in support of the policy, what we find is that despite non-motorized transport being an important recommendation in the policy, there hasn't been much funding by the central government to support non-motorized transport. But this does not mean that the central government does not want to fund non-motorized transport. As I said earlier, it is linked to several of the issues at the ground level. That are cities recognizing non-motorized transport as a critical issue? Are the local engineers, the local planners, local politicians identifying it as a key project? Because, if you make a strong case for developing non-motorized transport in your city, as, you know, the city, local city government, and then go to central government for funding under the National Urban Transport Policy. I don't think that they will refuse on that. So it's very important that though we have now a framework at the central level, we have funding at the central government level, that the cities also respond to that in a manner that promotes non-motorized transport. So as of now, the approach by the cities has essentially focused on, you know, that give us funding for buses, or give us funding for metro rail, or give us funding for flyovers. But the cities have not actively, or I would say hardly, asked for funding for non-motorized transport. So until and unless that awareness at the city level comes that, you know, we want to promote a world-class non-motorized transport network in our cities, you know, world-class cycle tracks in our cities, I don't think anybody will be able to help the cities. So from that perspective, I get a little negative about the future of NMT in India. So it's very important, I would say, that cities start, you know, thinking about the future of non-motorized transport in their own cities, and then, you know, go ahead with that. The next question I'm going to take is from Shazia Parvez. She's from Pakistan. Thanks, Shazia. Shazia has asked us that, is there any suggestion about existing road system to promote safe cycling? Well, yes. Shazia, I am not aware about the road standard, design standards that are followed in Pakistan, but definitely for Indian cities. So as I said in my presentation, the problem in India is not that, you know, cycle tracks are not there in the design standards for roads. They are very much there. So all we need to do is that strictly enforce those road standards. For example, it is required by the Indian Road Congress codes, which are essentially the Bible, I would say, for constructing urban roads, that all the main roads. So I would say that it is just about ensuring reservation of a lane for cycle tracks on our streets that would make cycling safe. Without this, it will be very difficult for us to, you know, encourage people to come onto the roads and start cycling, given that, you know, the road traffic, you know, car traffic, two-wheeler traffic, essentially dominating our roads, and it's, you know, very kind of... that was the answer to that question. So what I see now is that I've taken three questions. We're just on time. So thank you all for joining us for this webinar. I hope there were some new things that you learned from the webinar, and you were able to kind of, you know, extract something interesting from the research work that we carried out. You can always access our work on our website. The web link is displayed on your screen. So thanks once again. I thank you for joining us.